It is something as simple as a bird chirping, an airplane flying overhead, or footsteps walking down a long hallway. The sense of hearing is something that many of us take for granted. Cochlear implants allow for people who are deaf or extremely hard of hearing to hear for the first time or to hear once again. The Reborn Project examines the technological features of the cochlear implant, and at the same time explores how the technology has impacted the deaf community and a wider class of devices that augment the abilities of the human body. This project attempts to shed the light on the increasingly blurry definition between ability and disability. So how does a cochlear implant work? Sound is created through pressure waves in the air and comes in contact with the device worn behind the user's ear. A processor receives the analog sound signal from the microphone in the device. The analog waveform signal is converted into a digital signal that will be translated and implemented by the implant's internal electrode array. The signal is sent from the processor to the transmitter. The receiver sitting inside the skull gets the signal. The receiver interprets the digital signal and assigns direction, intensity, and speed of electrical impulses to be delivered to the cochlea. Two electrode arrays are intertwined with the cochlea. Along with the array are small electrical nodes. Each one delivers a separate electrical pulse along the length of the cochlea. The electrical stimulus in the different parts of the cochlea recreates the sound at different frequencies. The electrical pulses from the cochlear implants replace the missing vibrations in the cochlea that give hearing people a sense of sound. Michael Corris is a cochlear implant recipient and author of Rebuilt: How Becoming Part Computer Made Me More Human and Worldwide Mind. Here he talks with Team Reborn about how cochlear implant technology has evolved.
When this device was first activated, or rather, when my left ear was first activated, the software I had gave me 8 channels of auditory information. So basically what I did was I took all the sounds of the world and divided them up into 8 frequency bands. So I took all the lowest pitch sounds, directed them to 2 particular electrodes. So the next higher pitch sounds, sent them to 2 electrodes. So it chopped up the world to 8 frequency bands. You know, by comparison, your ear hears thousands of frequency bands. So it's a very dramatic reduction of the frequency resolution of the ear. Anyway, so I started out with 8 channels. But a year later, I got new software uploaded into this that gave me 16 channels. And 2 or 3 years after that, I got software that gave me the equivalent of 191 channels. So I've gotten new software several times, and that's been an upgrade each time. So that's one way of upgrading, just software alone. The second way is to replace the processor. So this is actually my third processor. So my first processor was actually a box about that big that I wore on my belt. And there's a wire that went underneath my shirt up to a headpiece on my ear. So the technology couldn't be miniaturized to be this small. So that was my first processor. The second processor was behind the ear processor. But it didn't have all the features that this one did. Then I got this one about 5 years ago. So, you know, new processors come out every couple of years. So that's the second way you upgrade. The third way, which is very rarely done, is to remove a device, surgically remove it, and replace it with a new cochlear implant. That is almost never done for just the purpose of upgrading the implant itself, because the surgical risk of removing a device outweighs the potential gain of putting in a new implant.
As Dr. Corist explained, there has been rapid growth in the technology behind cochlear implants. Children are implanted at younger and younger ages, and the deaf community has to rapidly adapt. The Alexander Graham Bell Association for the Deaf and Hard of Hearing, located here in Georgetown, advocates for an oral deaf education. There's a sharp divide between an education that focuses on listening and talking, and one that relies on American Sign Language. Children who receive an implant rarely learn sign language unless they grow up in a deaf household. Sign language is key to deaf identity, and many children with cochlear implants grow up in the hearing world. There are fears in the deaf community that cochlear implants will eventually eliminate deaf culture. As a self-described cyborg, Dr. Corris describes the potential future for cochlear implant technology.
It may be that you've come to the limits of what you can do with electricity in a cochlear implant. So there's been a lot of discussion of trying to come up with an entirely new technology that uses light to stimulate the cochlear, an optical cochlear implant. This is still very early kind of lab testing stages and using infrared light, which can actually stimulate nerve endings under some circumstances. Another possibility is genetically modifying the neurons in the cochlea so that they will respond, they will fire when they see different frequencies of light. That's an even more exotic technology. And these open up the possibility of creating cochlear implants that will give much better frequency resolution than the current generation of electrically designed cochlear implants. These are all distant possibilities. Even more distant is the idea of hair cell regeneration, where rather than creating these prosthetics that work around the damage, we'd actually cure deafness by regrowing the structures in the inner ear that are damaged in most cases of deafness.
The future of human and computer interaction is only going to grow as processor gets smaller.
What scientists and doctors are able to do in the future might enable people to go beyond their natural senses.
Labels such as deaf or disabled could change as technology lets us repair and enhance our abilities and senses.
Cochlear implants are a profound technology that have radically changed the deaf community and the implications of what technology can do to help humans. They are only just the beginning, and we look forward to seeing what cochlear implants have in store for us in the future.